20 years ago, director Roman Polanski fled America rather than face jail after pleading guilty to having sex with a 13-year-old girl. Well, now, reportedly, Polanski may be working on a deal to return to the United States. And for the very first time on television, the young woman at the center of it all is telling her story. Nanette Barucha has our exclusive interview with Samantha Geimer.
I'm Samantha. I'm not, you know, Polanski girl or this girl or that girl. But, well, you don't tell anybody who you are, I guess. You leave them to call you what they will.
For 20 years, Samantha Geimer has remained silent until now.
Do you feel like a victim?
No.
Because people have also called you that.
Right. Well, I mean, I suppose, yes, I was a victim, but I don't feel like a victim now.
Maybe it's because she is now a 34-year-old woman, not the little 13-year-old girl she was in 1977, when fate walked into her San Fernando Valley, California home in the name of Roman Polanski, a man later accused of drugging and raping her, an event that would for 20 years force him into exile and her into hiding. It would change both of their lives forever.
Look, I know it's a very large piece of news for all of you. It's a lot of sensational stuff.
I knew he was famous. I mean, I knew everybody else certainly thought he was a big deal.
A big deal he was, as the acclaimed actor and director of films like Chinatown and Rosemary's Baby, Polanski had made a huge name for himself in Hollywood. But the Polish-born director also met another side of Tinseltown. In 1969, Polanski's famed actress wife, Sharon Tate, was brutally murdered by Charles Manson's gang while carrying Polanski's unborn child.
I was hurrying home because apparently I had to go to some kind of school with her.
Despite Polanski's tragedies, he continued to triumph.
How did you learn that you were about to meet him?
I guess my mom probably just told me, you know, he wants to come and take some, you know, photographs of you.
In the early part of 1977, Polanski was commissioned by a French magazine, Vogue Homme, to shoot a glossy spread on little girls of the world.
I found it quite an interesting enterprise because I like the girls of this age.
Through a friend, he'd heard about an attractive young girl living in the San Fernando Valley. Her name, Samantha.
Do you think your mother was excited about the prospect of you being photographed by Polanski?
I'm sure she, you know, thought it was a great opportunity for me.
It was an opportunity of a lifetime for a little girl who wanted to be an actress.
I wanted to be like a movie star.
And to have the Roman Polanski photographing Samantha couldn't have been better for her career. Though Samantha says neither she nor her actress mother knew the shoot was for a publication described as a sophisticated French men's magazine.
He didn't tell my mother, you know, what kind of pictures he was taking or anything like that. So he was not completely forthcoming.
She didn't suspect or have reason to doubt that it was anything but...
No. If it was someone who wasn't famous, she might have been more careful. But when there's someone, the celebrity, they don't seem like a stranger.
Though Polanski has said in his own biography he thought Samantha was, quote, nothing sensational, he picked her. 7 days later, a test photo shoot was underway near her house. It would be the first of two shoots. Reportedly, Polanski asked Samantha's mother not to attend, telling her it would inhibit her daughter.
We sat down. He took some pictures of me. You know, he was giving me instruction. Turn your head, look this way, smile, don't smile. And then he asked me to change my shirt. We were outside, but there's no one around, so I turned my back and changed my shirt.
So you took your blouse off in front of him?
Yeah, you know, I turned, but yeah, in my 13-year-old mind, I'm thinking, this is what, when you're a model, this is how you're expected to act, you know.
But you were maybe trying to appear worldly to him or older than 13?
I was 13. Definitely trying to come off a lot more sophisticated and mature than I actually was.
Why?
Well, I guess at 13, you don't want to be treated like a child.
But she was a child who admits that topless photos were taken as she changed. At 13, Samantha says she was into her pet rat and her school friends, though she does admit she had a boyfriend. She would later tell Polanski about that boy when a second photo session was planned to shoot the spread for the magazine.
The second time, I was nervous. I was uncomfortable about what had happened the first time. I hadn't told my mom, I think, knowing that she wouldn't let me go. But I was uncomfortable because that made me uncomfortable that he wanted to take pictures of me topless.
In fact, Samantha says she invited a friend to go along on the second shoot, a March 10th, 1977 session that would begin at the home of Jacqueline Bisset and end in one of Jack Nicholson's bedrooms.
Nanette Varusha continues our exclusive interview with Samantha Geimer.
I was going to take a friend along. And at the last minute, when we were about to get in the car, he said, no, I don't think she should come. And I went off to the shoot, and my girlfriend went home, and Mom thought she was with us.
Samantha says a half-hour photo session, fully clothed at Bisset's house, put her at ease. Bisset and others were there.
I was outside, kind of looking at the view of the valley by the pool. He came out, he took some pictures of me there, and then said we were going to go to Jack Nicholson's house.
Apparently, Polanski knew Nicholson wasn't home. He told Samantha the light would be better there for photographs.
What kind of conversations had you had with Polanski up to this point?
Well, like honestly, I remember him talking about himself. But when we were in the car, I think before we went to Jacqueline Bisset's house, he was asking, do you have a boyfriend? He asked me that, yes. And then he asked me, have you had sex with your boyfriend? And I thought, oh God, this isn't cool. And
what did you say?
Well, I said yes. Because I had once, and I didn't want to, I was embarrassed to be inexperienced. I don't know if he asked me how many times exactly, but I told him twice, because I thought once was embarrassing, so I said twice.
Which was a lie?
Which was a lie.
Later, at Jack Nicholson's house, more photos were underway, and Polanski offered the young girl champagne.
We took pictures of me drinking the champagne, so I drank a couple glasses even just for the pictures. I think it was after the champagne that then again he asked me to pose topless.
She admits the champagne had left her uninhibited, but after pictures were snapped of a near-naked Samantha in a hot tub,
then he decided to get in the jacuzzi, which is when then I realized, something's wrong here. This is not what should be happening. So I'm thinking, okay, now I'm in trouble.
You're scared?
I was scared. I mean, not scared in the, I was in mortal danger, but I was scared because I knew this was not appropriate. Mm-hmm.
In a panic, Samantha says she faked an asthma attack and got out of the hot tub.
He follows me in the house, and I was there in my towel, and, I was like, well, I need to go home, and he was like, no, why don't you
Samantha says
here?
Polanski also offered her a piece of a Quaalude, a powerful tranquilizer, which she took. He told her it would calm her. He also told her,
why don't you just come in here and lay down for a minute? Oh, no, it's okay. Come in here. And that's that. And then we were in the bedroom.
And what happened?
He had sex with me.
Do you remember it?
Mm-hmm. He wasn't hurting me, and he wasn't forceful or mean or anything like that. I just tried to let him get it over with.
Samantha says she did try to object, saying no a number of times. Yet in the end, she was afraid to be more firm.
Did you cry? Did you?
I cried after.
When?
After it was all over and I was back in the car.
It was Polanski who took Samantha home.
He told me, don't tell your mom. I think he might have said, it'll just be our secret.
But it would not remain one. Soon after, Samantha's family learned what happened when her sister overheard Samantha's phone conversation with her boyfriend. Authorities were notified, and Roman Polanski was later arrested and charged with 6 felony counts, including rape and sodomy.
Well, I like young women, let's put it this way.
Polanski himself has never denied they had sex, though he has long maintained it was consensual. In a rare mid-80s interview, he again tried to justify his actions.
And just it went a little bit too far, one of those on the session with this girl.
So you weren't angry with him?
I never had a chance to be angry with him. By the next day, everything was so blown out of proportion, and we're worried about people taking pictures in our windows. And so there was never a chance to separate that from everything else that happened.
Tomorrow, Samantha Geimer recounts the events after that night and reacts to claims that have been made about her. Yesterday, in her first sit-down television interview, the woman at the center of the Roman Polanski rape case spoke of the attack. Today, Samantha Geimer tells Nanette Berusha that she feels Polanski wasn't the only one put on trial in the media and in court.
I have a really sweet picture here of a 13-year-old girl.
That's my composite.
When you see that little girl, what do you think of?
It's like looking at my life when I didn't have any control over my life. Looking at me, my life when my life wasn't my own.
It was a time Samantha Geimer would rather forget, an event that cost Roman Polanski his reputation.
I have not much to tell you except that I'm innocent.
And cost Samantha her innocence and the freedom to grow up a normal child.
And everything was fine, and then in one day, nothing was fine.
Accusing the famous Polanski of rape, a man known for liking young women, brought with it relentless scrutiny.
Here you were, now an object of media attention worldwide.
Right.
How did that feel?
Oh, it was horrible. It was horrible. There's people parked out front of the house with cameras, phones ringing, National Enquirer banging on the door, my mom and her boyfriend and my sister. Everybody was totally freaked out. I had reporters come on campus to school, show my picture to people, ask them if they knew me. And then they later, as far as I know, printed those pictures with the caption, Little Lolita.
Accused by Polanski himself of being a seductress and labeled by the media and the judge as less than innocent, Samantha claims what followed the rape was virtually worse than the actual experience.
I was the bad guy. My mom was the bad guy. We had done something to him, and that's the way, you know, or we wanted money. We wanted something, you know, it was a scheme, and there wasn't a whole lot of poor Samantha going on.
Well, do you think Polanski himself was in part responsible for that?
Well, I think he was. When you commit a crime and you're facing jail, I don't blame him for the things he said and trying to get out of it and trying to cast blame elsewhere besides himself.
On my part, it was done with all innocence. I have to point out that the girl testified before the grand jury to previous sexual experiences.
Even in the mid-80s, in this rare interview, Polanski was defending his actions and seemingly blaming the victim.
But there is the fact that there were other men in her life, and that nobody else had the same problems that I had.
Samantha says she only had a sexual encounter once with her teen boyfriend. Amazingly, she doesn't harbor resentment toward Polanski for the things he said.
I don't think that he's an evil man or a bad man. But he clearly was, you know, lived to a different moral standard than, you know, I did.
Those morals now had him facing years of jail time if convicted.
Were you prepared and ready to go to trial if you would have had to?
No. That was the last thing anybody wanted.
In fact, she never had to. For her protection and at the insistence of Samantha's family, all parties agreed to a plea bargain arrangement. And just one day before the scheduled trial, Roman Polanski pled guilty to one count of unlawful sex with a minor, the least serious of the charges.
What did you think his punishment should be?
I didn't care what happened to him. I think someone asked me, and I said, well, they should make him leave the country. But I never said I wanted him put in jail.
But that's what happened. Judge Lawrence Rittenban, during a pre-sentencing hearing, sent Polanski to prison for psychiatric assessment. Polanski served 42 days with the understanding that at sentencing he would receive probation only. But according to Samantha, Judge Rittenban decided that time already served was not enough for Polanski. He would have to go to prison.
Nobody understands that, you know, we had reached an agreement and it was time served, and then that was reneged on.
Thinking he could go to prison for an undetermined amount of time, which could have been up to 50 years, Polanski headed straight to Los Angeles International Airport, where he took the last seat on a British Airways plane and fled Hollywood.
And at that time, I thought there was no more point of endure it. And I just left, as you know. that was quite a splash.
Today, Polanski lives in Paris, far from Tinseltown and its opportunities. He declined Inside Edition's request for an interview, but after 20 years of exile, recent reports have suggested the director is anxious to reach an agreement with authorities to come back. Surprisingly, Samantha Geimer is all for it.
That would be great. I really wish that this would be over.
So you really harbor no resentment towards him at all?
No. I mean, it's been 20 years.
Samantha, too, has gotten on with her life as a wife and mother of three boys. Looking back, she says, it was certainly a different time.
You know, there was a lot of people having a lot of fun in 1977 in Hollywood. You know, he wasn't the only one, and things were just different back then.
The event that changed her life has made Samantha reflective. Ask her about justice, she believes Polanski has paid enough of a price for his actions. With a stoic attitude, she says, much worse has happened to a lot of people. She now sees Polanski as a stranger and herself as healed.
If I were upset and I was carrying around these bad feelings for 20 years, it would have no effect except it would be bad for me. So I'm not going to hurt myself any further.